you would join us in our opening song. All of our hymns this evening are in the red hymnal. If you'd like to follow along with the music cover, as the lyrics are in the insert. So how are you feeling comfortable?
Gather your elements to share the meal, whether it's bread, wine, juice, and crackers, and we will share and celebrate this Christmas Eve. Because the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. I invite you to join me in this Christmas Eve litany that you can find printed in your bulletin. This is a night like any other night, but tonight of all nights, we remember how God became human in Jesus Christ and came into this broken and beautiful world as vulnerable and threatened and homeless, as love and light and life into the darkness of this night, we proclaim with the angels,
glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace.
This Christ is within and among us now. This Christ will come again in fullness,
bringing God's kingdom of peace, justice, truth, and joy.
Let us cherish this child of promise tonight. Let us listen to the story and sing it out. God's story, our story. By the tender mercy of God, the dawn from on high has come and will come again.
To give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Let us pray. Holy One, God with us, grant us peace on this night as we celebrate your coming. Give us joy beyond our sorrow, wonder beyond our expecting, and hope beyond our despair as we contemplate your birth. Light up our darkness, warm us with your presence, and be born in us anew. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ladies,
the weary world rejoiced.
first. In the ninth chapter, verses 2 through 7, it reads like this: "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, a then light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, and you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder, for the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and in his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." Here ends our first reading. Are there any kids around? I know there's a couple I see. If you want to come forward, if you're willing and able, come right here. You can find a spot on the red carpet. I just have a gift for you tonight. Now, you might have already overloaded on bees the last few weeks. How many of you have already had several candy canes? I see some adults raising their hand. Here, grab some. Ah, you all get a candy cane. Here you go, honey. No. We're going to give it to Mom. Now, before you run back to your seats and wrap the paper and wrap the wrapper and eat it, what does candy cane look like? A cane? Does it remind you of anything? Christmas? Why does it remind you of Christmas? Red and white. Do you know, it is also shaped, many say, like a shepherd's cane, right? A shepherd's hook. Now, what if you turn it upside down? It's something all anew. Have you ever done that before? Has anyone ever asked you to turn your candy cane upside down? No? Well, someone several years ago showed me this. If you turn your candy cane upside down, what does it give you? A letter. What letter does it give you? The letter J. And letter J stands for?
Jesus.
Best children's message ever, right? Who would have thought? Turn your candy cane upside down and it gives you a J for Jesus. Oh, they are flowers. Remember, every single day, not just tonight, not just tomorrow when we celebrate Christmas, but every day, that Jesus comes for you, because you are loved so very, very much. So much that God said, "I am sending Jesus." And we get to learn more every single day about Jesus, why Jesus came, why Jesus did this. And he was out of, do you see that word on that door over there? You might have to lean sideways, left and right. Love. That's the number one reason that Jesus came, that God sent Jesus. Love. Love for you. And turn around and look at all these folks here. Love for each and every one of them. And so, remember that, okay? Do you think you can remember that?
Yes.
Super. Well, I'm going to send you back to your seats.
Figueroa, you can bring this to your sister if that she wants one too.
And for anyone else who is wanting a candy cane, when you come up for communion, I'm going to set them in this front row. And so if you wanted to grab one on your way back after communion, I invite you to do that. But I'm going to do something a little different because we have a gospel, our next reading, and that comes from Luke. And I'm going to read a bit, and then I'm going to share a little bit, and then I'm going to keep reading, and then I'm going to share a little bit. Does that sound okay with you all? Okay. Well, we're going to start in Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7 is what I'm going to read first. This trip to Bethlehem. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. That means counted. All the people had to go to their hometowns and be counted. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius, the governor of Syria, all went to their own towns to be registered. And Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and whom he was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for Mary to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. This trip to Bethlehem. We're going to pause our reading there. As I think about this story that has been told in so many different ways over the centuries, it's been revisited time and time again, being told out loud, being sung through songs, being rewritten in children's books, in rhymes, and many of us have heard a version of this story somewhere. You might even know that it is also our story. A story that reminds us that good things are coming. No matter how young or how old we are, we need to hear this story. This is the story that shows us how much you are loved. This is the story that shows you how much you are loved. And whatever you are bringing into this place, this space, this evening, know that this will not destroy you. Keep going. Think of Mary and Joseph having to pick up and travel, of having to have their child in a place that they haven't been to. Mary wasn't surrounded by her mother, by her family. And just think of all the things that they were thinking of, that they were enduring. But this would not destroy them. And they would keep going. I remember a time that I was invited into trying a new spiritual practice, some kind of way to interact with God. That's what this invitation of the spiritual practice was, to listen for what God might be saying. We gathered in a large room, much like the sanctuary, except for there were no pews in the center, just a wide open space. And when we entered this space, on the ground was laying this very large maze. A really fancy name, a labyrinth. Do you know what a labyrinth is? Have you seen one before? Well, this one literally would fill the sanctuary. And that was the invitation. I had never walked a labyrinth before. We were invited to listen as we walked. We were invited to take our shoes off and walk on the paths that were outlined slowly, quietly, listening for what God might be saying. I'd never done this before. It felt kind of silly. Walking in a circle, and a circle, and another circle. What was I supposed to hear? What would God sound like? I found that this was one of the most uncomfortable practices I had ever done. Because I was told I had to be quiet and not talk to anybody for 40 minutes. For me, who likes to talk a lot, don't worry, we are going to be here all evening. That was hard. So walking in circles, seemingly going nowhere. However, this is where I found a still, small voice. It will come. It will come. That's what I heard. And as puzzling as it was, there was a voice that spoke. I felt like the voice filled me with hopefulness. There was like just this feeling of being at peace. In that short response, it was all that was needed at that time and in that place. I smiled, kind of like when you know no one is watching and you're just smiling and maybe laughing out loud, just in this joy. I left that space trusting that on my journey, whatever this was that I was encountering at the time, it would destroy me. That I can keep going. Whatever it was, for Mary and Joseph, the long journey didn't destroy them. That lack of hospitality, the no secure shelter didn't destroy them. The messy reality of Jesus' birth didn't destroy that family. We kept going. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then the angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord, and this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known that what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. Do not be afraid. Do not worry. Consume or think you must control it. Go out chasing for it or fixate your mind on trying to figure out how and when it will find you. Those shepherds in the fields, as they watch their flocks with their minds spinning, imagining how the good, the promises of life and love that had been foreseen, that they had heard over and over in their synagogues, in their cities, that they prayed. Truly didn't anticipate finding God in that labyrinth. And I know not everyone has those unique, crazy, like mountaintop experiences. God shows up in our daily, everyday moments of life. And so whether it was in a still room, walking in a locker room, somewhere else, like in a busy grocery store, bustling around. What is God saying to you? Much like those shepherds, I believe in what it's like to surrender. Surrender that day and every day, striving to love God and striving to love one another. Striving to trust, striving to have faith. Yet the most miraculous thing, especially when it comes to this kind of season, this time, for me who has a 7-year-old and a 2-year-old, these seasons tend to seem so magical, mysterious and filled with pondering and wonderment. And as adults, sometimes that beautiful wondering is harder to find. But I know that God is always there with God's people. God is always there, nudging and stirring and agitating and provoking and creating and healing and rearranging and guiding and empowering, much like those little candy canes, just simply turned upside down, reminding you that you are loved. You are loved this evening. Whatever comes next, you'll run home and have an evening dinner, some snacks, some cake, or get ready for bed, waiting for what comes tomorrow, that God comes to earth, God came down to you and me, that we might trust and listen, that we might live, knowing that this world will not destroy us, that you will keep going because you are loved and you are beloved. I'm going to leave you with this Mary's song that comes just prior to Jesus' birth. For Mary sings out loud and sings, "My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God. For God has looked with favor on the lowly. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me, the holy, in God's name. Indeed, God's mercy is for those who fear from generation to generation. God has shown strength in their arm. God has scattered the proud in their imagination of their hearts. God has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has come to the aid of their child Israel in remembrance of God's mercy, according to the promise God made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. God loves you so much. Know this to be true. God loves God's people. That through Jesus the Christ, the child who would come, God's love for you and me. The child of the poor, the helpless and hungry, the lowly and afraid, comes now. New life for this world. Love in action. This will not destroy us. We will keep going. Because Emmanuel, God with us. God with us. And God's love be with you now and always. Amen. Amen. And this time, we'll be receiving our tithes and our offerings. And turn off this light. This is this movement of generosity, being thankful and grateful for the ways God has moved in our lives. And so I will pass this basket around. And as we do this, I invite you to sing. Lift your voices and let us sing. We'll be singing Awake in a Manger in the first Noel.
Thank you.
Enjoy spending the first snow month.
Thank you.
all God's people, both near and far. After each petition, you'll hear me say, God, in your mercy, and I invite you to say, hear our prayer. Let's pray. With wonder and thanksgiving for you, Christ, for coming into our world, we lift up now our prayers for the church, for life on this earth, for the whole human family. Your infinite love is born to us this night, and with the choirs of angels, the church proclaims the good news. Send us out as messengers of hope. Hope to all your people. Encourage and empower us to keep going. For you are a good God, always and forever loving. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, you are pleased to dwell with all your creatures, and the whole earth sings for joy. Review the splendor of creation, from the smallest cell to the widest galaxies. Guide us to be wise stewards of your gifts for the sake of generations to come. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, in your authority over all nations, break the rod of oppression, and in every land, free all people from fear. Bring peace where there is war, compassion where there is suffering, and healing where there is disease. We lift up and pray for Ukraine, for Iran, Palestine, and Israel. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You cherish those who are most vulnerable. God, protect infants and children and bless those who care for them. Watch over women giving birth and those at higher risk and those who tend to see the disparities. As people pray, pray as you sit with them by bedsides, as you relieve anyone who is in pain. Shelter the refugee families and those who have no home, especially on these coldest of nights. Your loving kindness, O God, embraces everyone in need. Help any and all for whom this season is lonely or hopeless. Comfort those among us known to us, those who are experiencing distress of body, mind, or spirit, those missing loved ones and are grieving. We pray for Claudia and Jane, for Dolores, for Patricia, for Bill, for Jimmy, for Mike and Mary Sue, for Rose, for Mary Lou, for Manny, for Catherine, for Dexter. We lift up these names and those that rest on our hearts and minds.
He said, take and eat, this is my body broken for you.
Do this and remember me always. After the supper, he took the cup and he said a prayer of thanks over it, saying, this is a new promise found in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Drink and remember me always. We're invited in one spirit to say the words of the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For those at home, or wherever you are at, as you break bread, know that this is the body of Christ given for you. And as you share the juice or wine, know that this is the blood of Christ shed for you. You may share that with those around you now. For those here in person, we invite you to come down the center aisle. There is hand sanitizer as you need, because there will be little tiny chalices that you'll pick up, but then you'll move forward to receive the bread. There is gluten-free available. And then as you receive the bread, move to the two chalices where you'll be offered either wine or grape juice. Know that this is for you. Come exactly as you are. You are welcomed. Please come.
The song, 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 the song,
with the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. At this time, we enter into singing Silent Night and our candlelight. And so with sharing our candles as we sing, just a little bit of instruction. And for those at home, I hope you are bringing our candles as well as we sing. Here is the note of instruction. If you are participating, I invite you, whoever has a lit candle, don't turn your lit candle. If you have an unlit candle, you can turn that sideways to be lit off of the neighbor in front of you or beside you, and then hold it straight, and we can continue to add the lights. And so with that, we invite you to sing Silent Night as we begin our candle lighting.
Silent night.
generous blessing this evening. May the word that Mary brought to earth carry you into new and abundant life. May the word that Joseph cradled in his arms enfold you with love and strength. May the word that the angels proclaimed in song bring harmony to our world. And the blessing of the Almighty God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, be upon you and remain with you always. Go in hope, joy, peace, and love, and serve the newborn King. Amen. This time I invite you to blow out the candles, stand, and as we depart this space, Merry Christmas, and share that same Merry Christmas spirit with those around you as we depart to your places and spaces to celebrate. And I hope to see you tomorrow morning as well if you want to come and join us. We even are saying you can arrive in your PJs if needed. So peace be with you all and Merry Christmas.